Is that the sound of a ring pull? Even though the countries have rolled on by, we never dismiss the excitement of crossing into somewhere new, and usually the event is commemorated or noted by Bernard saying, "I've brought a bike to..." It may seem a small thing to many people, but to us, it's always exciting, and if this feeling is ever lost, then it will be time to go home. Rolling past the borderline, the 17th border shows a steady confidence in what needs doing. So well-versed are we in the nuances and patience required. It used to be so different. However, after 32 in-and-outs, as we call them, a confidence develops in being able to solve whatever bureaucratically comes your way. This is true even if you cannot understand the paperwork. The exit from the Tyneside is not what we expected, as stories tell of people being strip-searched or of their bike being dismantled in the great drug search. It's a border where people get nervous due to many things possibly going wrong. And while anything could have been in or on the bike, in our case, however, not a pannier was opened, not a question asked. Again, despite all the stories, never has there been a problem on any border so far. It's not mattered whether it involved a black-uniformed Serbian guard or a machine-gun-toting Pakistani. In many ways, we've come to believe people react to how you are. Thus, a smile can be infectious, and an offered handshake has never been refused. Sometimes, even a shared cigarette can solve a problem which seemed insurmountable only minutes earlier. I leave that situation, however, to Bernard. The Malaysia side takes nearly 2 hours of walking from window to window and from office to office in the heat. Arranging only a month's insurance for the bike, the local police issue us with a temporary import disc the size of a dinner plate that's consigned to the pannier for if the police ever stop us. While the hours pass getting into Malaysia, it would have been far longer if we were going the other way, with queues to get into Thailand being enormous. Coach after coach are parked along the road, and the form filling itself would probably keep Parker Pen refills in business for years. Passing the long line of traffic going in the opposite direction, we set off towards a recommended hotel, which turns out to be more of a hostel than anything. It all starts off well, until hordes of children descend as part of a two-family setup. Our room sits between the two family rooms, and with the number of children they have, it's obvious their television must have been broken for most of their early married life. It quickly becomes budget hell, and like something from a wildly exaggerated sitcom. The children will be swinging from the lights if they could move the ladders from the corner of the building to reach them. It's chaos, pure chaos. Doing our best to be philosophical, we wander around the town, staying out of the chaos for as long as possible, until the children burn themselves out, searching for a glass of beer in an Islamic state. Despite hunting through every supermarket fridge, not a single drink can be found. Heading back to the hotel, sulking, Bernard reaches for his earplugs to block out the Simpson-like families and retires for the night. Falling fast asleep in his artificial quiet, I lay awake hearing every noise in the hard-surfaced building, until hours later, he sits bolt upright in the bed saying, "Is there a party going on?" "I think it's a revolution," I reply. "But then again," I continue, "it could be a popular uprising with the natives revolting." "Is that the sound of a ring pull on a can?" he mumbles. It's amazing, really, how, for a sighted person, his hearing can be exceptionally good when required. Even though the kids from hell are still racing up and down the corridor, exercising the full extent of their considerable lungs, he still manages among this tornado-like activity to hear the sound of a ring pull. Getting dressed, he sets off to investigate the sounds of World War III and finds a dozen men laying around the reception area drinking beer, while the helpful headscarf-wearing Islamic receptionist opens tins of Heineken for them. Coming back muttering, "Am I missing something about an Islamic country here?" he tells of the pile of takeaways just delivered. It's obvious they're in for the long haul, as the empty tins mount up while the noodles go down with raucous laughter. After listening for another hour, we consider leaving and riding for the first time in the night. Rule 1. Don't ride at night. Bernard assures me the roads are fine, and the traffic, if any, does have rules, and so it'll be a gentle trundle through the night before finding somewhere early to stop. Getting up and repacking our few belongings, it takes 3 trips to the bike to reload it at 2 a.m. And as the men realise we're leaving, they start to engage with us. Gathering around, they ask about the bike, the journey, where we've been, enthusiastically taking pictures with cameras and mobile phones. Picture after picture is taken as we pose in the darkness with them climbing on and off the bike. It turns out they think we're leaving on an early start towards Singapore. They're so nice, we don't have the heart to tell them the real reason we're leaving. Is this a typical British response, perhaps? Who knows? Our decision wasn't, we think, an overreaction, as no sleep was ever going to be possible, even with earplugs, as the festivities were obviously on for the night, by the amount of beer Bernard described. Thus, for the first time, we set off into the night, with a dozen happy people waving us off. Within 10 minutes, the alternator light, indicating how well the bike is charging, starts to glow red, and the voltmeter shows no voltage coming into the battery. Bernard drives for the next 2 hours, trying not to touch the brakes. Eventually, he turns the sat-nav system off to conserve power, and all talking through the intercom is banned. Saving the precious battery to run the essentials, i.e. the engine and lights, we manage 130 miles by 4:30 a.m, before the lights run dangerously dim. It's obvious our night is done, and we reach a large service station just as the engine dies, with her battery completely and utterly flat. Drinking coffee, the unfolding of tool rolls and bike dismantling begins. The head torch goes on and, like the usual magician, tools appear from all over the bike. As the manual comes out, the petrol tank comes off, and all the leads are checked over, as the next few hours reveal nothing. The engine cover comes off, and myriad parts are described to me as the night air fills with the sounds of both heads scratching and pages being turned in the manual. Gradually, Bertha is laid bare in the car park as a crowd gathers to watch her dismemberment. Some wander off to get chairs so they can sit comfortably and watch as the process continues into the dawning light of daybreak. The top engine cover is removed, where a lead runs from the charging system, and nothing is apparent. Meanwhile, the mound of cigarette butts mounts to the point where it may soon block the road. As he puffs furiously, more and more chairs appear for the gathering crowd. When one person gets bored watching, their seat is soon inhabited by another. Bernard reads and rereads the same pages of the manual repeatedly to himself until I know it by heart and can recite each paragraph word for word. Still nothing is clear, despite the pile of bits in a nice circle around Bertha. Everything seems to point to one part. But Bernard is not sure. And anyway, it's the one part we don't have with us. Sod's law, really. As daylight starts to spread its heat, the head torch is switched off. The traffic increases, and coaches pull in to disgorge their passengers for rest breaks, and they join the chair-bound spectators watching us. In the end, the cafe staff refuse to let people bring their chairs close to the entertainment, as there will be nowhere for the actual patrons to sit. As always, many of the men know more than Bernard about fixing the bike, and the suggestions fly in a mixture of Malay and English. Bernard politely listens to everything and agrees with them. Yes, it may be that, but I've checked, and it's not. One young man, in between mouthfuls of noodles, makes several suggestions, to which Bernard thanks him and tells him he's tried those things. The same young man suggests contacting the Malaysian equivalent of the Automobile Association, or AA. He helpfully rings them, although Bernard is sceptical about how much they'll know about an almost 20-year-old BMW motorcycle. However, nothing ventured, nothing gained, and so he continues head-scratching until they turn up. At this point, he discovers the engine won't turn over at all. Not even a click, which leads to 30 minutes of checking leads and starter circuits before he discovers the bike is in gear. With some motorcycles, like this one, there's a safety feature that prevents the bike from firing up if it's in gear. Moral of the story? Don't ever work on a bike when you're dog-tired, have been up all night, and your brain has gone to mush. Eventually, the Malay AA turn up to spend 30 minutes marvelling and fondling all the shiny tools while Bernard continues to work on the bike. They jump-start her with Bernard's jump leads off their battery and then stand back to take the applause of the crowd as they tell everybody they have fixed the bike. Bertha rattles gently on her stand, ticking over after she's been reassembled and tools disappear into compartments and niches around the bike, while everybody is thanked for their assistance. Finding out that the small town Kuala Kangsar is not far away, we set off to cover the 8 kilometres. Instead, it's 28 kilometres, and everything unnecessary for life support, brakes, indicators, etc., are left alone as Kuala Kangsar appears. With one last sigh, Bertha gasps and dies, but thankfully on a downhill stretch to a resort hotel, where we coast to a halt under a tree and step off. It was to become our home for longer than we thought. The resort town is surrounded by spacious parklands and bordered by the Perak River, which cuts through the town, where the Sultan officially resides, being the royal seat since the 18th century. The parking for Bertha has plenty of shade, and Sully Yati, the head of housekeeping, turns up and is so nice that Bernard asks her where the Malay shops hide the beer, as it is obvious that it does actually exist. Offering to go and find some for him, he thinks for a few seconds before asking for 6 cans, increased to 8 when she prompts him whether 6 will be enough. Bernard suddenly thinks breaking down in Malaysia will not be quite so bad after all. Unfortunately for me, she does not think wine is available, and sadly this is confirmed when she returns with the dull clunk of cans but no delicate clink of glass. 2 hours later, with 1 can already gone, he admits defeat over Bertha, retiring to plan his next campaign in the morning. The morning brings the heat and humidity of Malaysia and continued mechanical searching. As Bernard rips out what little remains of his hair He decides he must order parts from England. But there's little idea of how long before they'll arrive. Between 5 days and 3 weeks is the best guesstimate. Cats wander around the resort and startle me when they suddenly rub against my leg while eating. Feeding them chips from our plate, more cats appear from everywhere. It's like a Hitchcock film, but with cats instead of birds. Sitting watching from walls, in trees, on cars, in the bushes, they all wait for some indication food is in the offing. A dozen wander around our legs under the table as we sit in the outdoor section of the restaurant, eating. Waiting. Always waiting. A bit like ourselves. Meanwhile, Sulliati is, I think, somewhat taken with Bernard, not being able to do enough for him. I tease him about being her blue-eyed boy, even with his brown eyes. And I can quite imagine him pulling his big, innocent, little boy look as he asks, "Are there any chairs for the veranda we could have?" Within 10 minutes, chairs and a small table arrive. "Do you have a clothes maiden we could borrow to hang some of our clothes on?" Bang, a clothes maiden appears for our washed clothes. After several days, I ask him to see if a bottle of wine is to be had. The next day, he pops the question into the conversation. "Sully," as he started calling her before continuing, "do you think..." I can imagine his eyes flutter, flutter. "It would be possible..." Flutter, flutter. "To track down a bottle of wine..." Flutter, flutter. She laughs, agreeing to go wine hunting for him as we sit messing with the bike. All the instrument lights have died as well. Eventually, she reappears with a bottle of Australian, and life is complete again. Finding a lovely little corner cafe, time passes, sitting, talking, and consuming cold drinks with curries and exotic salads. The Chinese New Year, Year of the Ox, is ushered in with streets filling with dancing dragons and invites from strangers to the festivities. Plates of food are pressed into our hands as people place small red envelopes containing money into dancing dragons' mouths, and Bernard introduces me to one cavorting around the square. The two dragon dancers in the costume do not understand I cannot see them, but the master of ceremonies does, keeping them still while I explore their costume. My hands trace the elaborate head as the rear paws scratch behind the head's ears. It feels like a big, scary, blue Father Christmas, all covered in fur and full of sharp teeth and fangs. Walking through the town, people now wave and say hello and how are you, as they become more familiar with the sight of us passing by. Schoolchildren in Islamic clothes shout greetings as word has gone around in the schools about the English couple or the blind woman. All the children greet us in their broken sentences. Many times we wonder if all the English teachers are in their classes saying, "And if you see them in the town, say, hello, how are you, or what is your name?" Both greetings are common, as everybody smiles and waves while car drivers stop to let us cross the road, indicating, "No problem, after you." Really helpful, as zebra crossings are scarce or non-existent. The promenade into town from the resort has signs declaring no bikes, cars or canoodling. The canoodling sign shows two people with their arms around each other with a big red line through the middle. Wandering past, hand in hand, we see teenagers sitting the regulation 2 feet apart under the watching eyes of passing people. For 2 days, a vertical wall of water falls from the sky, and the whole town stops while waiting for it to pass. Nothing moves on the streets, and cars pull over to wait for the onslaught to end. Bernard tells me you cannot see 10 feet, such is the volume of water falling from the heavens. Each time it happens, it comes in a wave and then, suddenly, it stops. It doesn't fade away, it just stops like some big tap has been turned off. Seconds later, the sun blasts out from behind the clouds and everything is turned into steam. You can smell it and taste it as everything is roasted as the water burns away. When not walking the streets of Kuala Kangsa, our balcony becomes our home, while schoolchildren play in the nearby grounds, chanting their outdoor lessons. They laugh so much, sounding so happy and excited, as Bernard tells me of his life in teaching. Years of experience and being told how there was too much laughter in the classroom, and of how his pupils cannot be learning properly. Of using music and cold drinks during lessons, years before it actually became a good idea. It's obvious when listening to him that he still misses it, even if he were stuck in one room all day, every day. Sounding wistful in the remembrance of how all the fun disappeared, as education and learning became replaced with targets, tests, and examination results, he gave up the unequal struggle in 2004. Then he'd gone to work for a large national sight charity. Lucky for me that he did. We listen to children singing into microphones and wonder if one of them will appear on Malaysia's Got Talent, called One in a Million here. One boy seems to dominate the stage, and what he lacks in vocal talent is made up for in pure enthusiasm. Meanwhile, the sounds of the mosque are frequent, and the call to prayer reminds us of Turkey and Pakistan. The sound tugs at you when you listen in silence, waiting for the final notes to fall away before talking again. We begin planning for the next leap to Australia and change our intended destination of Darwin in the north, as shipping is too expensive, plus it's flooded by the rain and crocodiles are swimming in the streets. So the decision is made to fly to Perth from Kuala Lumpur. Sully Yati arrives, clutching the precious spares after 5 days of waiting, and Bernard leaps up and down like an excited schoolchild, as Bertha will soon again be singing her sweet song of movement. He's so excited, he takes the stairs two at a time, as I follow him down on my own, using my cane. We've been here long enough for me to learn the resort layout and move around freely and independently. By the time I get to the bike, spanners are already in his hands. When I approach him, he watches as I make my way across the grounds, and his laughter tells me the cats are scattering in all directions, as if to say, "It's that woman with her stick again, mind your tails." Pressing the starter a little while later, Bertha growls into life as my companion hops up and down with happiness. The voltmeter shows full speed ahead for Australia. During our wait for the parts, we took a chance and arranged to attend a motorcycle overlander meeting in a small, off-the-track town called Mita Mita in Victoria. For many years, Bernard has been visiting an overland website and has always wanted to go to a meeting while on the road. Now there's a chance to tick off this dream, but only as long as the 2,000 kilometres across Australia is covered by the 12th of March. Our final day in town seems incredibly noisy, and something feels different, and not in a good way. Loud chanting fills the air as open-back 4x4s pass by, full of people waving flags, driving up and down the streets with slogans pouring out from loudspeakers. The crowds part for us on the walk back to the resort, while others step aside, until two long lines of Malaysian riot police, in full body armour, stand before us, complete with riot shields and long batons drawn. Suddenly realising something indeed is very different, photographers leap in front of us to take pictures, while camera crews turn their attention towards our sudden appearance. "Oops," comes from Bernard's mouth, on realising things are a tad tense right now, right where we're standing. Bernard.
When we get to the front of the line, it's obvious we've stumbled onto something very, very tense. I look at the line of riot police and give them small hand signals to ask, "Is it okay to go through?" Many on the front line give back little smiles, returning my hand signals to indicate which way to go as a small gap appears in the line. It is quite funny, as our appearance seems to take the sting out of the situation. Chanting declines as people watch us making our way through with our bags of shopping. Exiting the rear of the police cordon, the chanting regains its volume before receding into the distance as we make our way back to the resort. Somewhere on Malaysian television that evening, there are probably images of us clutching shopping bags, wandering through the police cordon. Little did we know at the time, but it was the start of serious political unrest spreading throughout the rest of Malaysia.
After passing through the demonstration, the riot police had fired tear gas into the crowds, triggering a series of running battles with the people we'd passed through, once Friday prayers had finished, I hasten to add. In the evening and long after the sound of the demonstration had faded, lines of police vehicles pull into the resort to park on grass verges and fill every available space, disgorging hundreds of police. Bright sunlight finds the riot police lounging around the resort, watching the grass grow along with our multiple trips to and from Bertha the next morning. They're now on call, should they be needed, so Suliati tells us, as the staff gather for farewells and police wave goodbye as we pull out onto the road. Passing through the town, Bernard says farewell to all the little shops, the Chinese bike shop where bulbs and oil were bought, along with the little cafes we've come to know. The staff return our waves as they serve the little tables on the street as we pass them by. The main highway towards Kuala Lumpur is quiet as we head for a hotel booked on the internet days earlier. Near Kuala Lumpur International Airport, KLIA, our fingers are crossed as there's only the roughest map of the area on the petrol tank and no Malaysia maps on the sat-nav system. The signpost to Kuala Lumpur soon changed to KLIA, and everything is running well with the hotel suddenly appearing like a magical beacon on the side of the road. Following the sign right to the entrance of the hotel, a security guard salutes, lifts the barrier, and we pull into the car park where staff rush to find a big parasol for Bertha, to shade her fevered brow from the truly awesome sun. Climbing off the bike, within seconds I'm dripping with sweat, as a wall of heat and humidity drenches me instantly. The hotel has been converted from the dormitories of the workers who lived here to build the airport, but the facilities are fine and it has everything needed, close to the airport and the cargo offices of Malaysian Airlines. The evening passes with a group of Belgians in Malaysia for the MotoGP racing at the Sepang circuit, and they ask the smallest details about what it is like to ride a motorcycle this far, this long, and alone. They express great envy, as it's something each of them has always wanted to do, much like many other people we've met so far. Morning comes early, as Bertha has to be scrupulously clean to enter Australia due to the rigid quarantine restrictions. and negotiations occur with the migrant Bangladeshi staff of a nearby car wash. Four of them descend on the bike, covering her in soap, scrubbing furiously until she shines. Dusty grey trim turns black with the liberal use of elbow grease and polish. The tyres are washed, looking new an hour later, and she looks likely to pass muster for the Australian authorities. Everybody is delighted with the outcome, as Bernard pays twice the minimal asking price, and hands are shaken all round. In the morning heat, the entrance to KLIA arrives, and negotiations commence through multiple layers of tight security to the cargo depot. Hours pass, and eventually six officers lean over the shoulder of a colleague who resolutely fills out reams of paperwork for a motorcycle now completely wrapped in protective cling film and waiting to be loaded onto a pallet. Helpful suggestions fly around in many excited voices, calling on Bernard to assist as nobody can read our English documents. Eventually, everybody is satisfied that all the I's have been dotted and all the T's crossed, and we can wave goodbye to her. Our own five-hour flight passes in the blink of an eye, talking and laughing, not even noticing the passage of time, until Perth appeared below us. Banking hard left towards the runway, I voice my thoughts over whether any of the Indian passengers attempted to bang on the side of the aircraft to let the pilot know it's okay to turn, as they do on the buses to tell the driver it's safe to turn or overtake. Bernard chokes on his drink at this distant memory of so long ago, made real here and now, as the descent begins towards Australian soil. We feel happy to be nearly halfway around the world, despite losing nearly 6 weeks with visa problems and a budget shot to pieces as the pound has plummeted on the foreign exchange market. There's still a feeling of satisfaction. 12,000 miles, give or take. Having crossed Ireland, France, Switzerland, Italy, Croatia, Bosnia, Montenegro, Serbia, Kosovo, Macedonia, Greece, Turkey, Pakistan, India, Nepal, Thailand and Malaysia, we are still laughing, despite everything. Or should that be because of everything? Overcoming problems, be they barriers, breakdowns or silly rules, we've done it alone. The funny thing is, living by our wits and ingenuity, it's not hard to do. Yes, there have been some very, very hard times and arguments when tired, hungry or frightened. They've happened when we've been unsure what to do or when extreme heat has led to sipping water, making it last while looking for our next meal. The hard times have included extreme conditions for a two-up road bike, wondering how far we can cover before falling off, before seriously hurting ourselves. All through this time, when squabbles have happened, they've not lasted long. Bernard told me before leaving England, we will not be fighting with each other, but with the conditions or with our own fear. It's never personal. Remember that. It's this simple thought that I've tried to keep in mind, as it allowed us to survive being constantly in each other's company, as few people have ever experienced. 24 hours a day for weeks and months on end, alone. Setting our timetable, rather than being rigidly tied down to dates and places, has allowed us to meet and spend time with many fantastic people, some of whom took us in and looked after us as we passed through their lives. We've had tremendous experiences along the way, all of which are burnt into our minds. We talk about the things that used to bother us, little things that used to seem so big, the unnecessary clutter filling our lives, surrounding ourselves with possessions signs and symbols of who we are and what we own. Now, they're all gone. There are a few things really needed, but some are fundamental to your emotional well-being. Someone to trust with your life, along with the support of your friends and family. These people inhabiting our lives give us time to dream, to think the impossible, as many said this journey would be for me. They said the same for Bernard, given the peculiar difficulties he would face with my very presence and the strain it would place on him. The importance of those people around me who believed and supported us is something I knew all along. Now I completely understand and appreciate them more than ever before, being so far away from them. It's something Bernard and I have talked about as the miles built up over the months. We know they're there, and we care about them. Nothing much else matters, really. The wheels gently bump onto the runway, and the whole of Australia beckons us.